Thanks, Dario. So yes, welcome to my talk about transparent disk encryption. I'm Fabian Vogt, a release engineer at SUSE, and I'm first going to tell you what this talk is about. The goal of transparent disk encryption in this talk is to protect the data which is stored on this device you can see there. Basically, any laptop in the open, screen is locked or powered off, and there is important data you want to get on the hard disk. You have no access to the device. You might not have seen it before. You might be totally familiar with the hardware. You might even have helped the user with some task, but it's important that you cannot get to the hardware because there is cannot get to the data which is stored on the device because there is some important secret data saved by the user on this device. In text, this basically means preventing unauthorized access to data. But unlike current full disk encryption setups, where you have to enter a password on boot to unlock the device, in this case, you don't want to enter a password on the device. It should be truly transparent. So you can just plug the device in, hit the power button, and it starts up, and it has access to the encrypted data on the device. So it can use whatever workload you put in there, just that everything it's working with is encrypted. The added challenge here is that we are also trying to cover physical access in this case, at least to some extent, like if you have a laptop on the conference and it got stolen and you don't want anyone to have access to your documents. Well, it doesn't have to be a laptop. It can also be some kind of IoT or edge device like a Raspberry Pi you have somewhere in a public store, which has some credentials for logging into some online services. You also don't want anyone to simply grab the SD card and have access to those secrets or just take the entire computer with those secrets. It's also part of the goal to prevent some kind of evil mate attacks. If you haven't heard of the term evil mate attack before, it basically means that you have physical access to the device. You can modify it. The user still uses it after that, and by doing the modification, you gain access to the secret somehow. It's called evil mate attack because mates usually, or just cleaning crew, usually has access to important facilities of a building and can just go anywhere, and you're not usually thinking about them as a threat. But they really can be a threat in the context of high security environments. There are some parts which are not part of the goal, like protecting against denial of service. This is just impossible to achieve using software because you can just use a hammer or use scissors or just prevent that the system gets power. And yeah, then you can't really do anything about that. The system is down, you can't reach it. That's it. You can also just destroy the data. Then it's also gone. We can't do anything about that. You can try to prevent some denial of service attacks by redundancy and hardening the hardware against some tampering, but it's definitely impossible to have absolute guarantee that there's no denial of service possible. Some evil mate attacks are also not possible to prevent. One of the more extreme examples is you install a different keyboard, which has a bug inside that just transmits everything you type wirelessly to someone else. And if they enter the recovery key or a password, you get it. There's not really any feasible way you can protect against that. You can, or even more extreme, you can replace the entire laptop with a model which looks exactly the same, but sends everything to the real laptop and you can intercept everything like that. I'm not sure whether this counts as evil mate attack as well, but I would say it kind of does. I'm not sure whether anyone thought of this before, but it's something you pretty much cannot protect against, even if you're very careful. Main part is how we can actually get to this level of security. Obviously, address the data is to be encrypted. So if you have access to the, so even if you have access to the raw hard disk data, raw SD card, it is encrypted and essentially just random garbage. You cannot do anything with this data. But during runtime, DOS obviously has access to the decrypted data, but is responsible to make sure that you cannot get to it from the outside. So for the example of the laptop in the open, if the screen lock is on, DOS has to make sure that you cannot bypass the screen lock. If the screen is unlocked, well, you definitely have access to the data. The hardest part is to making sure that you can get from state A, that the data is encrypted and the system is powered off, to state B, that the OS is doing access control properly and has access to the decrypted data. This is the hardest part, and it really has to make sure that the OS is actually trusted and can perform access control. Otherwise, you could replace the OS with something that does not perform access control, and it just gives you the decrypted data. This is called attestation, to make sure that the system during boot only performs a certain task like decryption if the OS that is running on it is performing to a certain security guarantee in this case. You can also do tamper detection on top, so that if the system notices that something is odd, like some setting has changed, or some device, some untrusted device is detected, or something else got modified, then it can also refuse to boot. You can obviously take this to various degrees of trust, and it basically infinitely in either direction. You can just say, as long as the system is physically present, you can boot it by just having the key without any actual access control there, so that if you pull the hard disk, you have the random data, but as long as the hard disk and the machine are connected, you can get access to the decrypted data. Question is, where do we actually store the key? Even if you, to prevent that, you can get the key even you have, if you have access to the physical hardware. The answer to that is a TPM, a Trusted Platform Module. This takes care that the key is stored securely. A TPM is, for those who remember or know, smart cards aren't really that common anymore. It's basically a built-in version of a smart card. Originally, it was a separate chip on the main board or on a subboard you could plug in, connected to the low pin count bus on the main board. And it has various features related to security, cryptography, anything like that. It has a source of randomness, hardware random generator inside, and it implements several cryptographic operations. In this case, I refer to it as a hardware decelerator. While you can tell it to AES, encrypt, decrypt, do some hashes, it is just really slow, as you can probably tell by using as low bars. It's just a chip without any performance inside. But it's definitely meant to perform those algorithms securely. The main feature of it, however, is that you can use it to store private keys securely, and those never leave the chip. So you can basically say, I want a key, and it says, okay. And then you can give it data to sign, data to decrypt, data to encrypt, verify, anything like that. Just you never see actually the private key itself. The guarantee that gives us is that you can only do operations with this private key if you are in possession of this TPM or can communicate with it. This is very important, as it really means you can only get to the data, the encrypted data, if you are in possession of this specific TPM. You cannot clone it. There are a lot of specifications around this component, and they are pretty big and not that easy to read through. There are various parts and various versions. Everything works together there. The main three specifications are the TPM 2.0 library specification, which tells you which function calls you have, what you can do with the TPM, what the various states are, which algorithm it supports, which is over 1,000 pages. Then you have a specification which tells you how to use the TPM in an EFI platform, which is a bit smaller. And then you have the TCG PC client firmware specification, which tells you how a TPM is used on a personal computer. Instead of reading all of those, I really recommend to read a different book, which is called A Practical Guide to the TPM 2.0. It is freely available. You can download this as PDF, and it condenses all the important information in a actually understandable format. So you're not directly confronted with all the cryptographic stuff you expected to know if you actually read the specification. The main question is, how can the TPM trust the platform? Obviously, it cannot just give the private key to anyone. It really has to make sure that the system is in a state that the key can actually be transferred to it and it doesn't do anything malicious with it, like showing it to the user, for instance. And how that works is by measuring the boot. For every step in the boot order, you basically tell the TPM what you did, and it starts from the firmware. The firmware is implicitly trusted. This is called static root of trust, or static root of measurement trust. And it basically tells the TPM about every change of the system state, every relevant change of the system state, by adding certain hashes to platform configuration registers inside the TPM. Such a boot looks like the conversation on the right. The firmware tells the TPM that it's booting, it's doing a reset, and this is the only way to reset the PCRs to a zero state. And from then on, you can only add new hashes to those PCRs, which you might have already known from Alberto's talk if you listened to it. It's a hash extension function that, using the previous hash and the new hash, you get a new hash again, and this is the new PCR value. You cannot go backwards, and you cannot exactly tell how to get to a given PCR value. And based on those PCR values, you can then tell the TPM to perform certain operations with the private key, like decrypting some private data. In one of those boots, after the firmware tells the TPM that the PCRs are reset, usually the firmware itself is measured and the hash of the firmware executable given to PCR 0 in the TPM. The firmware then loads the bootloader, which is configured using EFI configuration variables, and the grub EFI binary is also measured. In this case, it is written to PCR4. PCR4 is extended with the hash of the grub binary. And the next step is then grub, which tells the TPM all about the command it is running and also the kernel and initrd binaries, which end up in PCR9 in this case. And once the kernel is running and the initrd is started, system decrypt setup finally tells the TPM that if PCR4 and 9 match some previously installed policy, which specifies those hashes, which can only be the case if this grub binary is exactly what we expected, kernel and initrd is exactly as we expected, and the grub commands which run are exactly as expected, only then will the TPM actually perform this decryption. Otherwise, you have no access to do the encryption. Obviously, this only works if there are certain assumptions, and those assumptions are true. The system really has to be running what the TPM thinks it is. Otherwise you can just tell the TPM, yes, I'm definitely running the bootloader, while you're actually running something else. The TPM is obviously not watching the system. The TPM has to trust what you're actually telling it. This means that if you know what the TPM is being told on a successful measured boot, you can just tell the TPM about the values it wants, and it will just say, yeah, okay, and perform the decryption. You can also do this in a system, in a running system in some cases, where you trick the TPM to reset the PCRs again while the system is already booted, and then you can start the measured boot from scratch. The TPM thinks that the system got reset, but it's still actually running, and so the state that it thinks the system is in isn't actually the state the system is in. The second assumption is that the data which the TPM transfers back to the system is only actually reaching the system that it verified. This is not always the case. Communication, at least for TPMs on a module, can be sniffed. It is a very low frequency bus and most of the time easily accessible. There's a picture on the right for a laptop mainboard, where someone just soldered directly to the TPM bus and just sniffed the key for such a transparent disk encryption while the system was booting. It is transferred in plain text. And there's also a different way, a much more complicated way to get to the key, is by waiting for the OS to boot. And once the root file system is decrypted, you know that the key is somewhere in memory, and you can read RAM contents unless they're encrypted. You can do that via various ways, like a cold boot attack, where you wait until the system is booted. Then you either reset the system and read the stale RAM contents from the last boot, which might not be cleared. Or you actually cool down the RAM so that it doesn't lose content as quickly and swap them into a different PC where you can then read out the old contents. You might also be able to sniff the RAM bus if you have the very expensive equipment to do that. Maybe you can also downclock the RAM bus. Everything like that is possible. Obviously, this needs to be mitigated somehow. And one of those methods is to introduce a second factor like a pin, which is needed on boot so that the TPM actually knows, yes, someone confirmed that there is no tampering going on, that the hardware is in its expected state and the TPM is told the truth. Obviously, this breaks unattended booting and it's not transparent anymore, so we can't use that. It's still useful in certain cases to have a second factor like a pin or a USB drive with a key file on it. This is possible and definitely adds some security to the value. The more likely approach to mitigate those is a so-called FTPM, which is embedded in the CPU and firmware and not actually a separate chip anymore. Effectively, the TPM state never leaves the CPU chip and nothing is actually visible outside of the CPU and you can pretty much not extract any of the internal state using any equipment you can get currently. This should be pretty impossible, pretty infeasible to sniff, but probably not impossible if you have several millions and a lot of time. However, it might have a weakness. I couldn't find any data about this. There is not really any documentation from manufacturers for some weird reasons, probably security in quotes, especially security by obscurity. My suspicion is that the NVRAM, where the firmware configuration is stored, is also used by the firmware TPM for some storage. And that might be a vulnerability, because usually TPMs have some protection inside the chip that prevents you from reading out the values and setting new values without going through the TPM software layer. While such an NVRAM is usually on one of your plain old 8-pin flash ROMs, which you can easily replace or flash even while the system is off. This might make it possible to attack the FTPM in novel ways or even rolling back to a known state from a year ago without the system noticing. TPM 2.0 also introduced a way to encrypt certain parameters and data, but from what I can tell, but I'm not really sure about this, it doesn't actually work in our case because you need an active policy and the TPM already has to trust the system so that the encryption key can be exchanged. So this is probably out of the picture here. I hope it's not, it would be nice. In theory, it is possible because every TPM allows public key cryptography with a certificate from the TPM manufacturer. And this could be used to perform some secure handshake on boot. RAM content is probably the deal breaker in most cases, but also the hardest to actually exploit. The only measure which is actually helpful here is to encrypt the RAM contents. Very recent CPUs have features for this, transparent RAM encryption, but I'm not sure whether any of those are actually in production. And it also remains to be shown whether those are actually secure. It's definitely possible that during early boot, you can defeat the RAM encryption somehow. For instance, by messing with the BIOS state while it's booting. So we can just hope that manufacturers, when they implement this, are very careful about making this actually secure in the case of booting as well. It is definitely possible, as you can see with some game consoles, like the original Xbox, which I think also had RAM encryption transparently running. Unfortunately, it's used by game consoles mostly for digital rights management, which is not quite our use case, but it shows that in theory, it is also implementable. This is a list of the PCR values defined in the TCG, Trusted Computing Group PC Client Platform Firmware Profile Specification 2.0 version 1.04 section 234. Yes, this is quite a mouthful. That's basically what you have to deal with if you're working with this kind of stuff. And it defines which PCR is responsible for which content and which part of the boot process actually measures which data and which PCR. PCR index 0 contains hashes of the root of trust, hashes of the BIOS in this case, most likely the firmware itself, and some embedded options ROMs, platform drivers, stuff which usually doesn't change unless you update the firmware. PCI1 contains host firm platform configuration, so if you change BIOS settings, PCI1 changes on every boot. PCI2 changes if you change some UEFI driver and application code. I think this also includes GROV, I'm not sure about this. Platform PCI3 is about configuration again, and so on. The more interesting ones are PCI7, which contains the secure boot policy, which changes if you disable secure boot, which changes if you enroll a new key or change some key values. And the ones most likely important for us developers like us are PCIs 8 until 15. Those can be used freely by anything in the boot chain after the UEFI environment. PCR16 is used for debugging, and everything past PCR16 cannot be used for this because they can be reset during runtime and not only when the whole platform is reset. This means we can not use any of those later PCRs for any attestation of the boot itself. One of the tools we can use to make use of the TPM decryption is LUX2. You're probably familiar with LUX already. It is a pretty simple layer on top of block-based encryption. So you have some block cipher like AES, which encrypts each block on the hard disk separately. And the cipher key is not directly your password. Instead, your password, here called passphrase, plus some data in a LUX header, which contains a key derivation function. If you combine those, you end up with the cipher key, which you can use to decrypt the separate blocks on the partition. The header which contains that information can be stored separately. In this case, there's really just random encrypted data on the disk itself and nothing clear text, but this is usually not done. For LUX2, the main difference to LUX1 is that there is not only a binary header, but there is a second part after the binary header, which is in JSON. This contains key slots. And the most important feature of this is you can store arbitrary data in there. This is used, for instance, by systemdcrypt setup, which is on the next slide. You can use an online conversion tool with crypt setup LUXConvert and convert your LUX1 partition to LUX2 format. And you can even go back if you decide that you don't like it, unless you enable any LUX2 specific features, like using one of the newer key derivation functions or block ciphers, which are only supported by LUX2. Systemdcrypt enroll in systemd v248 and later supports enrolling keys in the TPM. And this is done fairly easily by just adding TPM2 device auto in etc grip tab. The default is that it only seals it against PCR7. So only if the secure boot value changes, you cannot unlock it anymore automatically. That is the default, and you can change that by specifying simply a different arbitrary set of PCRs or even no PCR at all. In that case, anyone with access to the TPM can just grab your block cipher key. The LUX header is used to store the data which is given to the TPM to get the block cipher key back. This is an example on how it looks like if it's sealed against PCR7, the default configuration. You have the policy hash, which the TPM verifies that yes, the PCR matches the expected value, and the TPM2 blob is some not really that complicated structure which contains a public and private key part, and the TPM does some stuff with this, and you basically get the key, the passphrase equivalent for unlocking out of that. Then we have GROP2. GROP2 supports measurement of commands like the effective config, where it tells the TPM about every command that it is running. So even if you set a variable to 1, it tells the TPM, I set this variable to 1. If you define a new menu entry, it also tells the TPM. And it also measures all of the loaded files. This includes the config file itself. This includes theme definitions. This includes fonts. This includes kernel and also the init ID. This ends up in PCR9 altogether. So even if you just change the grub theme, PCR9 will be a different value on the boot. Even if you change some white space in the config file, PCR 8 and 9 will be a different value on the boot. One of the Grub 1 forks supports automatic unlocking using TPM. This is only for legacy boot though, and only supports TPM 1.2. Then we have Grub 2.05, which gained support for reading from LUX2 encrypted partitions. It gained a JSON parser and all of the needed encryption stuff for unlocking those, but it doesn't have any TPM unsealing functionality for getting the key from the TPM. It only does the measurement. And the most important part about Grub in this case is that it can read from ButterFS file systems, which is necessary to work with the current system for booting from read-only snapshots by the Grub configuration files and the tree of Grub configuration files generated by Snapper. An alternative to Grub, which is much simpler, is systemd boot. It supports measurement of the kernel command line, but doesn't itself measure kernel and init ID. The kernel is most likely measured by the underlying firmware already, as it is loaded as an usual EFI executable, like systemd boot itself. So in this case, systemd boot and the kernel would be measured into the same register. But there is a pull request open to measure the init ID as well, which is just given to the kernel as data. This means the systemd boot configuration file itself doesn't need to be measured because we already have everything which it effectively influences boot, because only kernel command line, kernel and init ID effectively affect the execution in the end. Systemd boot itself can only load files it has access to using the EFI system calls. So it can only read from FAT32 partitions basically and the ESP. So the kernel cannot be stored in any encrypted partition or any Linux format partition X4, ButterFS, XFS. It has to be on the EFI system partition with the init ID. And there I am already at a small demo, how this actually works. I built a small image with Kiwi based on the OpenSUSE MicroS image. I changed Kiwi to generate a LUX2 encrypted partition instead of a LUX1 encrypted one, and set it to contain the built-in passphrase Linux. I had to do this because if you specify an empty passphrase in Kiwi so that it can unlock automatically if it tries an empty passphrase, Kiwi does something strange and configures LUX totally differently, which isn't useful, so I have to enter Linux once. On the first boot, you will see that it re-encrypts the partition with a random new key, enrolls the passphrase for the new key in the TPM, and shows a recovery key so that if for some reason the PCR doesn't mesh anymore on the boot, you can still restore access to the system. On subsequent boots, if the PCR matches and the TPM says, yes, you're allowed to unlock, then you do not need to enter any key anymore. The original encryption key, which would be the same for all deployments of the same image, are no longer valid. So every image from that point on, every deployment is unique. So now I'm trying to share my screen so that I can show you how it looks like in practice. Yes, this is a VM with a freshly assigned MicroS image and a freshly generated TPM state. In this case, it still uses Grub, but the kernel is on a separate partition and not encrypted, so it can just load from it. During the init ID phase, it'll ask for a passphrase, which is in this case Linux. I'll enter it, it unlocks the root file system, which takes a while through the key derivation function. And at some point, it'll say that it is re-encrypting the file system with a new random key. This takes a few seconds, but not too long. This is a feature of LUX2 as well, that you can change the block cipher key while the system is running. After the system is re-encrypted and it knows about the new key, it enrolls the key in the TPM. And then it shows a recovery key, which we would have to write down in case the TPM doesn't allow us to unlock anymore. If we forget the recovery key and the TPM also locks us out, then it's effectively gone. Your data is lost. But yet, I'll just ignore the recovery key and press enter. And the system should boot up normally. And it does. Now I can log in. Using the wrong password, of course. And I can show you that it's actually using looks on the slash node. Now, if I do a reboot, skip the grub timeout, it boots up using the same kernel editor D and grub. So the PCRs match and it unlocks the root file system automatically. And after Wicket is fine with the IPv6 timeout, which is in 5 seconds. I can log in again and it automatically unlocked without me having to enter any password. And that's it already with the demo. Now there obviously are some issues with this. System decrypt unroll itself always needs the passphrase or recovery key for re-enrollment. So if you booted the system, you weren't asked for the key and you want to change something about the enrollment like a new PCR, or if you booted the system into a new state, you had to enter the recovery key and you want to enable TPM unlocking again, you still have to enter the recovery key again because it does not try to use the TPM for unlocking or use the kernel key ring, which contains the block cipher. So that's a bit of an annoyance, but technically not that much of a blocker. One issue I noticed during my testing where I got a bit impatient and didn't always reboot the machine cleanly for each test, I instead did a force reboot or force shutdown. This annoyed the TPM and it triggered DA lockout mode, which is for brute force prevention so that you cannot just reset the TPM and tell it when the passwords again. So there is a timeout of several hours if you have some failed attempts. And I actually ran into that once and had to reset the TPM forcibly. You can configure this in the TPM, but if you don't, this can get pretty annoying and nasty. The biggest issue, however, is that we need to handle updates somehow. You definitely do not want to enter the recovery key every time you make changes to the system. And this can get pretty complicated. This is, for instance, how such an update flow can look like for OpenSUSE MicroS in this case, where you have separate ButterFS snapshots for each different system state you can boot into. One of the simpler changes is if you just create a new package, create a new snapshot of a package change, like you installed your favorite editor instead of VI. If you go there to the next snapshot, kernel and initRD are still the same. So the only change happens inside the encrypted part of the partition. So we don't need to mess with any of the TPM PCRs. We don't need to create a new policy. This works automatically and is already fine. It gets harder if you actually change something in the boot chain, like the initRD. If you update core utils, for example, it runs mkinitRD and you get a new initRD. This needs to be told to that the TPM is fine with this new initRD. If you install a new kernel, then not only the kernel changes, but the initRD changes as well. And you can also change both at the same time by doing a rollback to an older snapshot with older kernel and older initRD again. There's also the bootloader, but the bootloader has the very special property that if you upgrade the bootloader, it also influences the boot chain of older snapshots because there's just one bootloader on the whole system. If you update the bootloader, you have to regenerate the PCR values in the policy for all of those snapshots you want to boot into, even older ones and also newer ones. The same applies if you downgrade the bootloader or change some of the internal configuration values. Question is how we can approach this. There are also some even more tricky cases like we need to allow the next boot for updates, but also allow the current one in case the next boot fails and we do an automatic rollback using health checker, for instance. We definitely do not want that the system directly reboots because it kernel crashes or something like that, and it waits for the recovery key. It shouldn't happen, but bug-free software is, as we know, probably impossible, so we need to account for that somehow. tricky can also be that we need to disallow that older combinations of kernel and init ID can be booted. Otherwise, you can downgrade them purposefully and attack the system using a newer vulnerability in an older kernel. So for instance, you see a system, you make a copy of the full hard disk and old kernel init ID, then you wait a year until some root vulnerability got public, then you go to the system again, install the old kernel init ID, and it'll boot up just fine. There are some existing solutions which require unsealing during updates. In my opinion, this is not something we should do, because during those reboots, the system is essentially unprotected. This is what most of those solutions unfortunately do. So instead, we need to think about this, how we can approach this differently. One of the core questions is that we need to ask the TPM for the key at just the right time. Obviously, the more parts of the OS are encrypted, the earlier the key is needed. So for instance, if kernel and init ID are encrypted, you need to have the key before you can read kernel and init ID, so already in the bootloader. Once the key is available, measurement doesn't really do anything anymore because you already have the key in RAM and the TPM was already fine. At that point, you really need to protect that nobody malicious gets the key anymore. And there's also the question about verify or measure binaries. Verifying can be done by, for instance, using binary signatures, public key cryptography, that stuff, which is much more flexible than just one hash value you can measure against. But it is also much more complex to implement, also a bit fragile and hard to get right. And in the security point of view, you definitely have to actively revoke every signature you did for all the kernels, and this can get pretty complex. There is the related boothole 1 and 2 vulnerabilities, which were about revocation, I think. This is pretty much this, just even worse. One approach is to ask, while the bootloader is running, then you can encrypt kernel and init ID. Downside is the bootloader has to take care of all of this, so it needs support for LUX2, it needs support for TPM, and it needs support for the file system the kernel and init ID are stored on. Also, the bootloader needs to be very careful about anything that it does because the kernel is the keyring is in RAM. So if you gain arbitrary code execution in the bootloader, for instance, by using the grub command line to load your own binary or doing an exploit using a custom theme, which has some exploit in an image file, then you can get to the key. Another point is that the bootloader then needs to give the kernel the key, which it used to read the kernel again, so that the kernel itself can also mount a root file system. Upside of this is that only the bootloader itself is measured and probably also its configuration. So you don't need to tell the TPM about many changes. Different approach is to do the unlocking in the init ID. The advantage is that kernel and init ID are obviously not encrypted, but the bootloader then just measures everything. It doesn't need to do any verification on its own. It just tells the TPM about everything it does. If there's a malicious theme, which you can use to gain code execution in grub, it doesn't matter because the TPM was already told that it's using a different theme than expected, and it will refuse to give you the key for unlocking. The init ID already has support for LUX and TPM handling, so we wouldn't need to have any missing support in the bootloader. There is also nothing left to measure after the bootloader. So after this, the system is up and running and we don't have to care about it. We just have to make sure the system actually protects the key, like using a secure screen lock. Issue is the measured content also includes kernel and init ID, which change much more often than the bootloader itself. One approach to handle updates is by using system signed files. This means the bootloader, instead of measuring, verifies the kernel and init ID using public key cryptography, like GPG signatures or PE signatures. And those signatures are made by a system private key, which is stored on the encrypted part of the disk. Measurement only makes sure that the correct key of the system was used for verifying those files, and secure boot does the rest. It basically makes sure that nothing except the OS we expect boots on the system, but everything which boots on the system can then get the key. The kernel command line is a bit special because it's not really taken care of by secure boot alone, so it does need special treatment, which can be done by signing the grub configuration file or by measuring the command line as well again. The harder part again is that kernel and init RDs also need their signatures if revoked again. This looks a bit like this. On the current boot, everything is unlocked. And when you do an update and kernel and init RD change, you sign them with your current key you have access to because the root file system contains it, which is encrypted so that it's secure. And on the next boot, the bootloader notes, yes, the signature is correct, so you can unlock the rootfs again. A similar approach is to use signatures from the system vendor, like us in this case. So we provide a signed kernel and init ID on our own, where we have to make sure that those are actually behaving in a specific secure way when they notice that they're in an environment where they have to behave like this.
There is a question.
Yes.
Manas.
That signature which you generate can't be signed, can it?
How do you mean that?
Well, if you create a signature if on your previous slide or the previous one, they said you have to, generates private public key and signs a bootloader. So if the system generates a public public and private key pair, for safety or for security reasons, it really should be signed. The key pair should be signed itself, shouldn't it?
Yes.
Right. So,
well, not technically. You can also measure it. You can also tell that the public key is stored on the ESP, and you measure that the public key is always the same on each boot. You can use several approaches to do that. As long as there is a way that you can chain the signature from one boot to the other, it should be secure. And that it actually makes sure that
as you don't have access to it.
You have access. In the booted system, the rootfs is unlocked and you have access to the private part, so you can sign kernel and init ID for the next boot.
Yes, but that requires that the that key has to be present on the root file system. The signing key.
Yes.
Doesn't make it insecure?
That makes it not really more insecure. It's basically as secure as previously. If you have write access to the root file system, then you can do whatever you want anyway. And if you have read access to the root file system, you already got the data it's meant to protect, so it's already too late. This is my argument.
Okay. I'm still slightly unhappy with having the assign a key on the root file system, because that's precisely the problem. You would need to re-sign the init ID on every boot, whenever you generate the init ID.
Yes.
And
this is what vendor signatures would in this case avoid if you trust the vendor.
Wouldn't really help, because that would mean you have to send the init ID to the vendor for signing, which is.
In this case, I actually mean that we supply one init ID for everyone. And it is signed by a private key we don't use for anything else.
We can't do that.
The next slide is also about why we really shouldn't do that. So this is one approach we really shouldn't use. Because it means that we can, every device which uses our signature for unlocking the root file system can then be basically retroactively backdoored by us if we just sign a malicious init ID.
Yeah, and it doesn't work. I mean, this is not how we create init IDs.
Not yet. We could change that.
Oh,
but yes,
really?
This is also one point. We could change it, but it's not fun. You will probably get a fat init ID, which boots slowly and doesn't work everywhere. If you have third-party drivers, it also gets a pain. We also have to make sure that we revoke all previous versions. And yeah, it's not
no,
that much
no,
fun.
That doesn't work. It doesn't work either, because we actually encode the root file system in the init ID.
We don't have to. Dracut can root in a not host only mode.
If we don't, we have to put everything, every configuration on the kernel command line, which will
yes.
explode the kernel command line.
Yes.
Being that done, that doesn't work.
Yes. It's not fun. That's also why I'm against this approach. But I'm just listening it for completeness.
Good.
A completely different one, which does not rely on any signatures, is to have simply multiple sets of valid PCR values. So for each allowed combination of bootloader kernel etd command line, we install a separate policy using the TPM so that any of those combinations can boot successfully. The pain point here is that we need to predict every PCR value precisely for every future boots, even for past snapshots, which can get a bit of a pain, especially if grub is involved, because it has some really complex ways of generating those PCR hashes. You would have to fake execute the whole grub config file, which is not fun. This is, in my opinion, still the most flexible approach, as we really have a controlled list of allowed combinations of snapshots to boot. And we don't need to mess with signatures like revocation. And it's just much easier to have an overview. Going further is to prevent rollbacks attacks of the root file system using like DMVerity, EVM, or an entirely custom mechanism with TPN, non-volatile RAM registers, and timestamps. You can also do another approach like self-destructing what the TPM knows about it if you notice that someone tried to tamper with the system.
Just one quick thing, Fabian. We are pretty much out of time, so if you...
Yes, that fits.
...to conclude. Okay, thanks.
So for completion, those are some sources for license compatibility. And one quick notice, you can always just use some threats of violence to anyone who has access to the system, and you'll probably get access to the system as well. If you just say, yeah, I have a wrench, I'll hit you with this wrench if you don't give me the recovery key, that's probably more effective than trying to hack the system using some $1 million equipment. The only way to get ahead of those people is just make it impossible that any single person can access to the computer or just not have any way to access the computer without actually the computer unlocking itself. And that's it.
Okay, thank you very much again. There has already been questions which led to a very interesting discussion, and I don't think there is much time for others. So yeah, thank you again.
Yes, thanks for listening and thanks for questions, Hannes.